watched it shine down on me. I'm gonna spread my wings, yeah. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. He's
yours and yours. He wrote me my own What a Friend. Can we sing yours tonight?
There is one who stands by me. Promise that he never leaves. In my valley, he gives me peace. What a friend. What a friend. I am safe from wind and storm, safe from seen and unseen harm. Oh, peace and comfort in his arms.
time, I want y'all to help us do it. Lift your hands in this atmosphere and say, I am grateful.
Have done.
Look at him and tell him, yes,
I'm grateful.
The victories that we've won. Tell him I could go on and on.
About your works.
Because I'm grateful.
Praise you, Lord.
Lift your hands and say, flowing from my heart.
Thank you.
Surround me, Jesus. Surround me, Lord. Consume me with your love. Arrototo semelanai. Ora mani kiandolo non sinene. Yeah, oh Jesus. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Let your presence fill this place. Surround me, oh Lord, yeah. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord, yeah. Let your presence fill this place. Jesus, my prayer is today that you would surround me, oh Lord. And I'm gonna say, hey, can it all do? Surround me, oh Lord Jesus. Surround me, oh Jesus. Let your presence fill this place, Jesus. Surround me, oh Lord. I want you more than anything, Jesus. Surround me, oh Jesus. I want more of you. Gotta have more of you, Jesus. Surround. Hey Jesus, have your way in me, have your way in this place, Jesus. Show them I care and I. Oh Jesus, surround me, Jesus, surround me, Jesus, surround me, Jesus, surround me, Lord. Let your presence fill this place. Hey, let your presence fill this place. Let your presence fill this place. Fill this place. Ah, God. Fill this place. Fill this place, Lord. Fill this place. To the empty places in my heart and feel the place of you. I want your spirit, I want your nature, I want your power, I want your glory to feel this place, feel this place, fill this place with you, Jesus. Yeah, fill this place with you, Lord. Let your presence surround, wrap your loving arms around, surround me, Jesus, wrap your loving arms around me, Jesus, surround me, Jesus. Hey, oh, surround me, Lord. Let your presence, let your glory, let your power fill this place. In the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand, pleasures forevermore, pleasures forevermore, pleasures forevermore. At your right hand, Lord, pleasures forevermore. When you feel the place, everything not like you has to go. When you feel the place, depression leaves. When you feel the place, anxiety leaves. When you feel the place, freedom comes. When you feel the place, for where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is victory. Feel the place, Jesus. Feel this place, Jesus. Feel this place, Jesus. Feel this place, Jesus. Fill it with freedom. Fill it with power. Fill it with glory. Fill it with glory. Fill it with glory. Fill it with glory. Feel the place, Jesus. Let your presence fill the place. Let your presence fill this place. Let your presence fill this place. Surround me, Jesus. Surround me, Lord. I want to be with you, Jesus. In you I live, in you I move. In you I live, in you I move. In you I have my being. Surround me, Jesus, for my being is in you. I live in you, I move in you. Surround me, 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 Jesus, surround me, Jesus. Let your presence fill, fill the room with your glory, Lord. Let your presence fill this place, oh Jesus. Let your presence fill this place, Lord. This place, Jesus. This place, Lord. Feel this place.
carpenter, but you are the living word. Come on.
Sent down from glory.
Many things you were on earth. A holy king, a carpenter. Come on, Houston, you can say it one time with us.
Sent down from glory.
Many things. Come on, somebody say it.
Many things you were.
Awesome ruler,
awesome ruler,
gentle redeemer, God with us,
God with us, the living truth, and what a friend we have in you
are an awesome ruler,
awesome ruler,
together, this is what we like to call you, Jesus,
Jesus.
That's what we call you, yeah.
You
were born in a manger,
but on a tree you died to save man.
Jesus, that's what we call.
Good evening, family, friends. Just want to say thank you all for coming out. And this afternoon, there will be crying, there will be laughter from remembering the great times. And it's all, everybody say it's all good. it's all good. So just let it flow, let it happen. For Aaron, buddy of mine as well, but just know this: when we're crying, we're not crying for him. We're crying because we're gonna miss him. But understand one thing: that where Aaron is right now, there's no more pain. Where Aaron is now, he's blessed beyond measure. So to start the service, we're gonna do the one thing that Aaron loved to do, and the one thing that I know for sure that words can comfort. Sometimes you run out of words, but the Bible says the Holy Spirit, he is a comforter. So we're just going to take a moment and do what Aaron loved to do, which is worship. So if you don't mind, you can stay seated, you can stand. We're just going to sing a song and just worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We bless you, Lord, we bless you, we honor you, God. Oh, how we need you, give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. For great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour.
Lord, on behalf of Aaron's entire family, I'd like to thank each of you who've come today to honor a great man. That's why we're here. And so many times at a time like this, we don't know exactly what to say. You know, we get uncomfortable, we get awkward, and what I've seen so many times is that we repeat cliches that probably we've heard somebody else say. But if I could be honest with you today, that usually doesn't help anything at all, and some of them even hurt, you know. I do not believe that God needed another rose for his garden in heaven. That's not what this is about today. But I will tell you what is so important, and that is just your presence means so much to this family. In the days and weeks and months to come, they may forget what people said, but they will remember the comfort of knowing that you cared about their loved one and that you were here today. And so I really do want to express appreciation for that. And for those of you that are watching online today, if you'll leave a comment below and tell us where you're watching from, and maybe leave a comment about Aaron and your relationship with him, we're going to compile all of those in a printed copy for the family. And so we appreciate the fact that you've joined us today, even though you couldn't be here physically, that you are a part of this. You know, Aaron was a remarkable man, as far as I'm concerned. And I think even the attendance shows the number in a COVID world on a weekday afternoon. It's amazing that this many people would be able to come together to show your honor and your respect for him. But I've learned things about him over the last few weeks that just make me marvel. He was a pipe fitter by trade. And this is no slam on any of the pipe fitters in the room, Anthony. But pipe fitters aren't generally known for being artistically gifted. But Aaron was quite an artist, an amazing artist that you can see surrounding us on the stage and on some of the slides that went by earlier. But more importantly than that, Aaron cared about people. Here at CLC, he organized and led a ministry to prisoners at Cook County. Even though I think every prison ministry I've ever known about was people who, because of their own testimony, because they had been, their lives had been changed by being in prison, and their desire to pay that back by helping someone else is usually what motivated them. But that was not the case with Aaron. He had never been in trouble with the law in his life, received Christ at a very early age, and yet Aaron cared about people, and he wanted to help. He served here at Christian Life Center in our altar ministry, which means that he made himself available every Sunday after the service for anyone who wanted prayer. As people would come forward, he was dedicated to serve them and to pray to God on their behalf. And yet, I found a note this week in our database that he also had expressed an interest in working in our children's ministry. So prison ministry, altar ministry, and kids ministry, even though he was a senior and a grandfather, he was interested in helping children because he loved people. And he also loved the Word of God. I asked Xavier about some of his favorite verses, and he sent me a text this week from his dad about a year ago where Aaron had encouraged his family to read a certain passage of Scripture from Mark chapter number 5. Which contains the story of Jairus, a man in Scripture, a ruler there, whose daughter was very, very sick, and the woman who had an issue of blood. Both of those stories converge in those few verses, and evidently something about that spoke to Aaron, and he wanted his family to read it and meditate on it and pray about it. And when I read those verses myself, the last verse in that passage I think was prophetic for today, even, because Jesus said to her in verse 34 of Mark 5, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Your suffering is over." And that's exactly what all of us could say today, that about Aaron and to Aaron, that his suffering is over and he is at peace in the presence of the Lord today. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this good man that we honor today. And Lord, while we do not sorrow like those who have no hope, I thank you for that. But I also pray for those perhaps who do not know you as Lord and Savior, as Aaron did. And I pray that your Holy Spirit would minister to them, to comfort them, but also to draw them into the same kind of relationship that Aaron had. I pray your presence would fill everything that we do today. Anoint every word, every song, every testimony. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask Deranz Brown to come and sing. And then after he's completed his song, we'll have the reading of the obituary. It's one change from your program. This will be Dr. Beverly Lowe who will be reading the obituary. But first, let's worship with Deranz.
As I look into the hills, which cometh my help cometh from the Lord. In all thy ways acknowledge God, and he will direct thy path. I find it an honor and a privilege to be able to celebrate the life and the homegoing of Aaron. I thank Walter for inviting me here to sing when he asked me to, and I appreciate it to share with such a great man. I'm attempt to sing for you guys, and I ask that you all, you can join in, you can clap. And I give you the best I can. Amen. I don't know why, Lord, I have to cry sometimes. I don't know why, Lord, I have to sigh sometimes. But there's going to be a perfect day when troubles get out of my way. I don't know why, but I'll find out by and by. Oh, I don't know why, Lord, I stand in the need sometimes. I don't know why, Lord, my poor heart will bleed sometimes. But there's going to be a perfect day when troubles get out of my way. I don't know why, Lord, but I'll find out by and by. Listen, you say, you know the Lord, he moves in mysterious ways. His wonders, they are to perform. He plants his footsteps way out on the sea, and he rises on every storm. Oh, his ways, they are hard sometimes to understand. No matter how hard we try. Oh, I don't know why he let some things happen to me. Oh, I'll find out by and by.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord. This is a time where we come to honor a mighty man of valor. I asked the Lord to give me a word, and he gave me a mighty man of valor. You can just look around the room and see a mighty man of valor. You can just look around the room and see a man who served God and served God's people. You can just look around, and I heard Pastor talk about the importance of how he wanted to serve, not only in the marketplace, but also in the church. A mighty man of valor. Remember the family. Remember the people that are here. Remember how each person shares with you how much they loved your loved one. And when we get to the acceptance stage of our grief, we would have grieved in a healthy manner. You have my condolences, and I thank God that your loved one served God. And I will read you the obituary. Aaron Truesdell was born on February the 22nd, 1958 in Chicago, Illinois. He was preceded in death by his father, Robert Lee, mother, Elizabeth, two siblings, Anthony, John, and brother-in-law, Willie Earl Jones. Aaron leaves behind his two children, Aaron and Xavier, with his ex-wife, Sandra. He has three grandchildren, Travell, Xavion, Zayden, along with his granddaughter-in-law, Trinity, and Faith, who he loved dearly. He also leaves behind five other siblings, Sharon, Walter, Tyrone, Marvin, Robert Jr., along with nieces, nephews, close friends, and family. Aaron was a very talented and natural artist since his birth. He accepted Christ at a very young age, was baptized at Progressive Baptist Church, and rededicated himself to Christ in his mid-20s. He was so smart and talented that he even skipped a grade in middle school. Aaron graduated from CVS High School on the south side of Chicago. After graduating high school, he attended college at Prairie State, the Art Institute, Palette and Chisel, and American Academy of Fine Arts in Chicago. Some of Aaron's awards includes a first place in the Black Creativity Art Show at the Museum of Science and Industry, third place in the Austin Jays of Chicago, and honorable mentions from the Buried Art Exhibition at the Museum of Science and Industry and the DuSable Museum of Chicago. Some of his past clients includes the Chicago Museum, Four Seasons, Bessie Coleman Library, Fleetwood Jordan Art Center and Theater, the Black Military Museum, the Better Boys Foundation of Chicago, Seaway Nation Bank of Chicago, and many, many others. Aaron worked in the steel mill as a young man and is a retired foreman sprinkler fitter from Sprinkler Fitters Union Local 28. Aaron was a very sweet, kind-hearted gentleman, dedicated dad, grandfather, and a mighty man of God. He loved to visit his children in California, but he stayed in Chicago because he believed that he had unfinished work to do. Now we all truly see what he meant. He was not only a dedicated member of Christian Life Center, but also a founder of the prison ministries at the Cook County Jail. He brought church and God to everyone he came across. Even if you've never heard of God or church, he was the man who would introduce you. He never took a title because he never really cared for them. He always loved family, children, life, baseball, sports, nature, and he strongly believed that your actions speak louder than words. Maybe it was because he had so many great qualities. He was a strong Black man, a role model, father figure,
uncle, brother, cousin, nephew, leader, counselor, minister, disciple, and prophet. And most of all, he will be forever missed. Loved and cherished by everyone. Thank you, God, for blessing us with your son. And thank you for bringing Aaron Truesdell back home. God bless you.
This time, I'd like to ask Warnell Danner and Tony Battle and James Gibson to join me up on the front row, if you would. They'll be speaking to us in just a moment. But first, Deranz Brown is coming back with another music, another song for us. So let's worship with him as he comes. You gentlemen, join me up front.
Praise the Lord, saints. I'm going to come to you with another selection. You know, sometimes things happen into our lives and we don't know why they happen, but I know it is in God's plan. You know, and we can't argue with what God's plan is. He knows us better than we know ourselves. I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days and some sleepless nights. But when I look around and I think things over, all of my good days, they outweigh my bad days. I won't complain. Sometimes the clouds may seem low, so low we can hardly see the road. So I ask the question, Lord, why so much pain? But he knows what's best for me. Although my weary eyes, they cannot see. So I just want to say, thank you, Lord. I won't complain, because he's been so good to me. He's been good to you also. He's been so good to me. More than this whole wide world could ever be. He's been good. My God's been good to me. He wiped all of our tears away. And he turned our midnights into day. So I just want to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You put shoes on my feet. Thank you, Lord. You put clothes on my back. Thank you, Lord. You put food on the table. Thank you, Lord. He woke us all up this morning. Thank you, Lord. I won't complain, because he's been so good to me. He's been so good to me. More than this whole wide world could ever be. He's been good. My God's been good to me. He wiped all of our tears away. And he turned our midnights into day. So I just want to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I won't complain.
Good afternoon, family and friends. It is indeed an honor to be here today to celebrate the life of my true brother in Christ, Aaron Truesdell. My name is Tony Battle, and Aaron and I was best friends. And the reason I say that is because he treated everybody like a friend. So I want y'all to know it's official. I'm the best friend. So just let the record show. But truly, he did. He treated everybody with love and respect like a best friend. And clearly, me and Aaron, we met 20 years ago right here at CLC. We used to sit in that section right over there. And when Pastor Jerry would get up in the morning and say, greet your neighbor next to you, three or four people, say hello. You get that happening in you all's churches and things. So that turned into, those introductions turned into a 20-year friendship. So close that we eventually started doing breakfast together every Sunday. So every Sunday, me, him, and Travail would go to our local restaurant here and have breakfast. So we had the first official small men's group at church, me, Aaron, and Travail. So we ate. But what happened is, through those introductions at breakfast, you get to really discover and learn each other. You get to spend time. That's like doing life with them. You get to learn and study each other. And I wrote down some things what I actually discovered in Aaron through those introductions. The Word of God says you will know them by their fruit. You will know them by their fruit, not by what they say. And what I found in Aaron was consistency. The things he said in his life that he lived were mirrored each other. So oftentimes we hear people talk one thing but live another. That was not Aaron Truesdell at all. The man that you heard speak wisdom was the man that you saw walk it out as an example to us. But some of the characteristics I found in Aaron Truesdell, and we mentioned it earlier today, a true man of God, a true man of God. Now, why do I put the word true in the front of that? Because sometimes we use that like a cliche. I think Pastor Jerry mentioned it like a cliche sometimes, but there's no cliche in Aaron's life. The man you saw and met and witnessed was the true man of God, and he set an example for us. So if you get nothing else from your experience with him, use it as an example, as the loving, caring man of God that we all know him to truly be. I have him down here as a true man of God. He was genuine in all that he did. He had wisdom. When you talk with Aaron, you heard the wisdom of God. He didn't give you his opinions on things. He gave you scripture. He gave you things in a non-threatening way, a non-condemning way, but you heard from God. You heard wisdom come out of his mouth when he spoke. I found him to have godly conviction. There was no compromise in Aaron's life at all. There was no malice, no agendas going on there. He had godly conviction, and he stood by them. There was no compromise in his life. I found him to have a servant's heart, as we talked about before. Pastor Jerry mentioned it earlier. But he had a servant's heart. He served everybody. He served everybody, whether it was in the prison ministry, whether it was here at the altar ministry, in life. He just served people. Many of us are recipients of that blessing. We are here today, not because you met him at the altar or anything like that, but he touched your life. He touched people, not just those that he knew, friends and family, but those he didn't know. Now, some of you all might know, after retirement, Aaron was driving for Uber. And he used to tell me stories, because we talked from Texas. I moved to Texas some years ago. We talked numerous times a month on the phone. We would talk. But Aaron would tell me about his Uber experiences in the car. Because Aaron witnessed and ministered to everybody, he had a captive audience. So when you're in the Uber car, it was his church. The front seat and the steering wheel was his pulpit. The back seat was his pew. The passenger seat was his resource binder. That was his resource table, because every church has to have a resource table. So he had a resource table right there. But when you get in the car, he would talk to you about just life. He just makes conversations and talk to you about things going on. And people talking to him, they couldn't get out the car because they didn't get to their destination yet. And sometimes I think Aaron took the long way around, so he had more time with him. But he has a captive audience. Then he said that it's already paid for, because he paid for it through the app. So it wasn't like they weren't going to pay. They paid for it. But he said he would have people get in the car. And I remember cases where he talked to people. It made no difference what race you were, what religion you were. He just talked life with you and brought God into it. People would get out the car thanking him for the conversation. Thank him for the insightful conversation. He told me about young ladies who would get in the car, want to go out on a party. They're getting their party on. And he was talking to them about life and what's going on. And they get out. At the end of their ride, they don't want to party no more. It wasn't in no more. They didn't feel like it. They get out, put their skirt down. They feel like, I don't even dress right now. He didn't condemn them. He just shared godly principle. But they received it. They asked him they said, what church you go to, Pastor? He says, oh, they're going to come here, Pastor Jerry. They're going to come visit. Because he already said, they said, what church you go to? And he told them. And they said, I think I know that church in Tinley Park. So they left with a witness, with a testimony. Aaron Truesdell touched and changed lives. He didn't just interact with you casually. If you met Aaron Truesdell, your life was blessed. You were changed for the better. Isn't that what we all should want? To change lives for the better? To impact the body so people could come to know Christ? He talked to perfect strangers about this. It wasn't a prepared message. He just talked to people about the things of God and an Uber driver. Now, he did tell me that a few times he got some pretty significant tips, some $50 tips, $100 tip people would give him. So how many know that I was ready to go drive for Uber? I'm going to be an Uber driver. If you're going to give a $100 tip, I'm going to drive for Uber. I'm ready. But to Aaron, it was a ministry. It wasn't just something to do. It came out of Aaron because it was actually in Aaron. So he didn't have to work at it. He didn't have to make it happen. It was just who he was. It was in his fiber. So when he talked about these things, it was so natural and so organic that people loved him for that, as we are testimonies and witnesses here of that very thing right there. Right now, the word says here in Hebrews, it talks about this. I'll just be brief. It says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run the race with endurance, the race that is set before us. Was that not Aaron? Did he not lay aside every weight and sin? There was no compromise, no guile in Aaron. There wasn't anything going on in Aaron's life that we could speak of. He lived this out. He laid aside everything, every distraction that would try to come his way. He laid it aside for the things of Christ, and he ran the race. He ran the race with endurance, the race that was set before him. Are we running the race that's set before us? We need to be doing that, as Aaron was an example to us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of his faith. Then it says, I have fought the good fight. I can imagine, even as Paul was talking to, praying this as he was nearing his life, it says here, I have fought the good faith. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. I have fought the good fight, have finished the race, and have kept the faith. I can imagine Aaron saying that in his final days. I can imagine him saying it to the Lord. He ran the race. He fought the good fight. He ran the race in such a way that we should be using this as an example. My wife and I was talking about it. Aaron has impacted our lives in the 20 years I've known him and the 10 years I really spent intimately with him living here, that we was talking about how we want to be so much better in impacting lives for the positive, letting our light shine, letting the testimony go forth without compromise. That's how he impacted our life as his brother in Christ, that I feel like, having watched him live his life as an example, that I want to be better at what I do. So Aaron's impacted my life in that way, and my wife's as well. So thank you so much. I just want to share with you what my brother has done in my life. We were so close that he was the best man at my wedding. He stood right with me when I got married. That's how close we were. So I love Aaron. I thank you all for this time, and be blessed. We're praying for you all, and go out and use Aaron as an example. Amen.
Good afternoon, family. Just want to send my love and prayers to the family. I know it's a difficult time for everyone. I just wanted to read this poem about my uncle. The title of this poem is We Had a Wonderful Uncle. We had a wonderful uncle, one who never really grew old. His smile was made of sunshine, and his heart was solid gold. His eyes were as bright as shining stars, and in his cheeks, fair roses you would see. We had a wonderful uncle, and that's the way it will always be. But take heed, because he's still keeping a close eye on all of us. So let's make sure he likes what he sees.
Okay.
Got it. Let's do it together.
Hold on. You guys, excuse me. It's kind of hard. Okay. All right. His journey just begun. Don't think of him as gone away. His journey just begun. Life holds so many. I can't even see the word.
Facets.
Life holds so many facets. This earth is only one. Just think of him as resting from the sorrows and the tears. In a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days and years. Think how he must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of him as living in the hearts of those he touched. For nothing loved is ever lost, and he was loved so much.
Thank you, family.
My name is James Gibson, and many of you probably saw my story or read about me in the newspapers or saw me on TV. I'm Uncle James as well. Before the kids was born, I was his first son. 40 plus years ago, he took me into his home. We lived out in Richland Park. He worked at the steel mill, and he did everything that a father would do. And he welcomed me into his family with his other brothers, Walter and the rest of them. The story I got to tell today, Aaron been a great man since day one. He didn't only love people, he worked for people, he did everything for people. 30 years I missed. Before I got here, I was kind of mad, and then I was kind of sad, and then I was kind of glad, and then I was kind of happy. But he came into my condo and he turned on a light the other day. And he told me, don't be mad. The reason I was mad, because it seems like it's never enough time. And my story is, I was taken away from our family for 30 years. I've been since released and exonerated and given all my rights back. The first African-American in the country that has ever proven against the law enforcement agency torture since the abolishment of slavery. And I had 9 months with him since I've been out. And so I feel kind of sad, but I feel glad because the word cannot come back void. For those that believe there is a God. In 2005, he came into a cell, a prison cell of mine, and told me in Pontiac Correctional Center that I was coming out, that I was gonna be exonerated, that I was giving all my rights back. And when I got out, my son, Aaron, and Zay, I call them sons because I was the first son. He gave me his room when Aaron was born. He took care of me. And when I got out, they took me to a spa or something. And when I really couldn't recognize people, you know, because people had changed, they had age. And so I really didn't know who people were. You know what I'm saying? It happened so fast. But when I seen Aaron, I knew who he was. Out of all the people that I didn't know, I knew Aaron. I knew that man that took me as a little child to the first Cub game. He loved the Cubs. He was he's our Michelangelo. He's our Picasso. Can you see it? Show your love for a great man. He loved music, but most of all, he loved his kids. He loved his family. He ain't never wavered from sea to shining sea, all the way across to LA. Even in the midst of a pandemic, he still showed his love. We are living in a horrible time. These people done put upon us something that we can't even understand. But we know one thing, there's truly a God in heaven. And Aaron has been doing his thing 40 plus years. His best friend spoke on 20 years. Add my 20 with it. That's 40 plus. So this ain't nothing new for Aaron. This is not a sad occasion because he was a mighty man of God. He's sitting on the right hand of God. He was a great servant. He paved the way. And he'll pave the way for you, 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 and you. Because he said, if my people would turn from their wicked ways, then would he hear their prayers and hear their land. So this ain't a sad occasion. He's gone to a place that all of us trying to get to. And with that, we're gonna miss you, Aaron.
Would you receive Pastor Gregg Lowe as he comes to bring the word of God to us today?
Praise God. Praise God. I don't know, but I feel like I'm one of them best friends too. I mean, Aaron and I go back, way back. Did I say way back? Way, way back. We went so far back that he and I were born 2 days apart. Same year, same month. And I just thank God for his life. I thank God for how he impacted each and every one of us. Thank God for this ministry. Thank God for Pastor Jerry and the entire family here. But also, I just thank God for the family. I know that this is a time that it's hard to celebrate, but we must celebrate. Why do we celebrate? Because we know that our friend, our brother, our father has made it home. Out of all the times I have stood in this place, this has been, when I thought about coming before you, I am so honored to stand before each and every one of you to celebrate the life of my friend. Not only are we born on the same month, 2 days apart, but we worship together. I don't know, some of our progressive members are here, but we sang in the choir together. We were on the usher board together. We worked together. Aaron and I, we sold women's shoes at Baker's Shoe Store in Evergreen Park. So when my brother said that he was one of Aaron's best friends, you know, me and Aaron go back a little bit farther than 20. We got about 50. Matter of fact, Aaron even worked for me in my company for a while. How much more can I share with you than already has been said? We know him to be a great man. We know him to be a man of valor. We know him to be a man that loved his family. But one of the things that we know by the example is that he is an example of a man that loved what God loves. Say, that just happens to be me. That just happens to be you. That just happens to be everyone that he came in contact with as he was their chauffeur. But, you know, I looked at some things about this man of God. When I looked at his name, Aaron, means to an exalted, strong, and is of the Hebrew origin. According to other different theories, the name could also derive from a various Hebrew word meaning high mountain or mountains of strength. Did you know Aaron to be a strong man? But most of all, Aaron means someone who knows how to act according to the code of honor, the code of God. He may not have always voiced his thoughts, but what he does say, he would always say what he thinks and what he feels. And sometimes it might be funny, but he would say it not just to please people, but to please God. Because he knows that if he will share a word of encouragement to draw people, not to him, but to the Lord. He was always a giver of compliments. Did Aaron ever compliment anybody around here? And for many times he would do it, but to do it to not just to make, but to make people feel good, to encourage them. I love what was said about him when he was driving. He would encourage people in such a way, women got out of his car and said, I don't even think I want to go there no more. That's the power of a man of God, a man of valor. But you know, when you think about Aaron, I think about how when God told Moses to go tell Pharaoh to let my people go, Moses said, wait, you know what, God? I don't talk very well. I don't speak very well. So God says, take your big brother Aaron with you. Take your big brother Aaron, and you know, Aaron was in the Bible of Exodus 6 and 10, it was Aaron was a priest. Did you know Aaron Truesdell to be a priest? A man that would speak the word of God, would share. And you know, Aaron had a real special relationship with God. And as we can see, Aaron had many gifts. Just look around at the gift that he has to literally see something and put it on the canvas, to touch the lives of people over and over again. His art will continue to live on years from now. It's almost like a book, where it will keep on sharing the good news. I love the fact that he was not a minister or called himself a minister, but he walked as a minister. He carried himself as a minister to share the good news. And you know, not everybody is able to go into the prison system. Not everybody will go, as Pastor said, who did not experience it, but had a love for people that can you imagine God saying, he's saying to God, who can I send? Aaron said, send I. I'll go. Go where? Go where everybody else won't go. To set the captives free. They may not have been set free from behind the bars, but they were set free in their hearts and their minds, and to know to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and they will be free indeed. A lot of people are incarcerated right now, locked behind doors, locked but without doors. And some people who are behind doors are more free. Aaron was the kind of man that will come into your life and free you from some things. He was the kind of man that we all need to be like. You know, I titled this Aaron and Jesus. And the reason why I say that is because once you meet Jesus through the man of God, you know that there is some additional hope. And the hope that I'm talking about is what Jesus said in John 14. Let me read it for you. I'm almost done. John 14 says it like this. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. We know where Aaron is. We know that he is with the Lord. But I want to read this from another translation. It's the New Living Translation. And I love this version because it helps us to really embrace it just a little bit closer. It says, "Don't let your heart be troubled. Trust in God. And trust also in me," says Jesus. "There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, I would have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you. And when everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me where I am." So we know that Aaron's assignment was over with because the Lord came and took him home. But there's something else that we know that is so true, because the Lord told us in Revelation 24:4, he says it like this: "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying. There should be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Our brother has no more pain. He has fought the good fight, and he has gone to receive his reward. And so for that reason, we can rejoice over his life. But as I come to a close, I want to share a story with you. I met a man by the name of Minister Dean Braxton. He went to the hospital for a routine surgery. He's supposed to be in and out. But as life would take a turn, he died on the operating table. And while he was dead for 1 hour and 45 minutes, he experienced heaven. Let me back up and say that again. He died and was dead for 1 hour and 45 minutes, and it has been documented. Doctors interviewed, and they couldn't understand it. But the thing I want to share with you is that while Dean Braxton was dead, his body lay there. He went to heaven. And he said while he was in heaven that his entire family, from generation to generation, met him. They all met him and they greeted him, and he met Jesus. And the love of his family and the love that he received from Jesus, he was so overwhelmed by the love, he couldn't believe it. And then Jesus says, "You got to go back." He said, "Huh? I got to go back to earth?" Jesus says, "Yeah." He said, "No, I'll just stay here and wait till everybody get here." Jesus says, "No, you got to go back and tell them. You got to go back and tell them to get their house in order. You got to go back and let them know that I am just as real as I have said that I was." And so Dean says, "Well, Lord, if you say so, I'll go." So he's been preaching and teaching and sharing his testimony all around the country about heaven and about how beautiful it is, just like the Word of God says. And then guess what happened? He got stage 4 prostate cancer. He said, "Well, if I die, I know where I'm going." But he said, "I made a promise to the Lord that I would finish my assignment." So he went to the doctor, and quickly the doctors did whatever they need to do, and he is healed, cancer-free. Why do I tell you that? Because you can't go until you finish your assignment. You are here with a purpose and an assignment on your life. If you have breath, you have a purpose and an assignment. And you can't leave before then. And I come to tell you that our brother, our father, our uncle, our friend, our best of friend, has finished his assignment. Now, I pray that everyone has accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior under the sound of my voice. And it's so easy to do it. All you have to do is say, Lord, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. I make you the Lord and Savior of my life. And now you're part of the family. And so now you're guaranteed to be with the Lord and to see our brother, our father, our cousin, our uncle, our friend, the servant of God once again. So as I leave you, once you have made that decision, because it is imperative that we make that choice. Let nobody fool you. Every man, woman, boy, and girl is going to have eternal life. But as I tell them at the barbershop, and you see I go often, you're going to either be in the smoking section or the non-smoking section. You're either going to be with the Lord or without the Lord. Let nobody fool you. God has already made the way. He has paid the price. You can't do nothing. You can't, well, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that to get to work my way into heaven. No, the work has been done by Jesus Christ. He has done everything to mend us back to the Father. He has done all. All we have to do is accept him. And I promise you, yes, this life can be a little troubling at times. We do have ups and downs. But I tell you one thing, God will take you through each and every one. And he will use each and every one of your situations and your circumstances, like my brother James here. He went through a bad situation, but now God has given him a platform to tell how God can keep you in the midst of a hell situation. And God will use each and every one of our lives to draw someone else closer, as he did our brother. He used his life. Because he was such a talented man, a man that loved God, a man that loved his family, a man that loved people. I encourage you today, let's imitate our brother. Let's imitate our father. Let's imitate our uncle. Because he was truly, as the woman of God said, a man of valor, a mighty man of God. To the family, Xavier, Aaron, Sharon, Walter, Marvin, we go way back. What's that, 1843? West 62nd Street? Be encouraged. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. And know that there's no better place for our brother to be than to be with the Lord. Amen.
I've been asked to announce that there is a repast immediately following this service in our youth auditorium, which is almost directly behind you. When you get into the lobby, there'll be a corridor on either side of the youth auditorium. You take either one of those as far as you can go. If you get to the parking lot, you've gone a little bit too far, but the youth auditorium's just before that. Seating is limited, especially with the safety precautions with COVID, but we will do our best, certainly, to accommodate the family and any of their guests that would like to stay. We do ask that you would wear your mask until you are seated at a table in the youth auditorium and any other time that you're away from the table. One last passage that I want to leave with you. This was something that Aaron had shared with part of his family, and I think he wants the grandchildren, the children, I think he wants the entire family to hear these words as we close from Proverbs chapter number 3. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do, and He will show you which path to take. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Do 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 do. Sometime the night they took my friend, try to black it out, but it plays again. When it's real, feeling's hard to conceal. Can't imagine all the pain I feel. Give anything to hear half your breath. I know you're still living your life after death.